So don't be scared. This is Eclipse. You will be seeing more of Eclipse later on. But first of all, I want to talk with a bit of PowerPoint ware, but then we will come back to Eclipse. I'm giving an introduction to Java profiling, which is kind of also generic for other languages. And I lost Singer. Oh, I'm back. OK. And this is well applicable also for PHP, for example, but also for .NET and our beloved iOS guys. But the tooling is only really good in Java. Java has the best tooling for performance troubleshooting, for profiling, and I want to show you some of that. So why we do profiling at all? And there are multiple reasons. There are many reasons. Everybody has their own reasons. But I think two reasons are really important. The first reason is we need speed. This is a cheetah. A cheetah runs up to 120 kilometers per hour. It's the fastest land animal. And it's so fast, so it's especially designed to be fast. It's so light, it has so many muscles, it has a very big heart. And after it has chased down its prey, it is so hot from a temperature of the body that it needs to cool down and walk around a bit before it can start to eat. So we want to be also in that position to have so fast code that our CPUs get hot so that we need to cool them down. And the second reason, I think, is that we need to learn. We need to understand. When we work in programming, in IT in general, or in Java in specific, we don't always know what's going on behind the scenes. So we do some code, and then we test it. It's working, it's compiling, it's fulfilling functional requirements, but we don't really understand it fully. So I don't understand it fully. I don't understand how assembler works fully. So there are a lot of gaps, and I'm always trying to learn more. I want to learn more. I want to learn more about Java. What's the tricks with code optimization? I want to learn. And profiling helps you learning and understanding. I want to start with an example, a quiz. So it's now no longer me working, it's you working. And I want to get some ideas. So I have two lines of code. I guess it's a pretty common code. And there are many things happening in those two lines. There are so many things happening that I want to ask you. What do you know that's happening in here? Say the line and say what's happening. Does somebody have an idea?
Yeah, you're testing a new error list with capacity of 10, I would say, which is
default. So you say there is a capacity which is not listed in here? That's good?
No. Yes. And the second line, you first create a string, most likely new one, and then add it to the first thing.
Okay, you say there is a string created, and you said it's a new one, and it's added to that error list. So that's good so far, but there is a lot of more stuff happening. What else going on? Lot of discussions. Any more ideas? So there is a capacity involved, you said. That's correct, and we don't see it. You say there is an array created. That's not correct.
Instantiated,
but still it's not correct. Since Java 7 update 40, it's not done on the first line. Since Java update 40, the array which is behind that array list is created when we add it. And that's happening in this magic method add. It's not just adding stuff to the array, but it, for example, invokes this ensure a capacity internal method, and it checks whether there is enough space in the array. And indeed, in the beginning, it's 10 elements large. And it's also incrementing a modification counter, which you need to get those nasty concurrent modification exceptions. So there is a lot of stuff happening behind the scenes. And my first recommendation is very far away from profiling, but it's a prerequisite, I would say. Please attach source code for everything you have source code of or can get hold of source code. You want to have the source code. And for Java, we are in the very good situation that source code is available. Attach it to your IDE and try to understand what's going on. And then you can do profiling. What we do with profiling, can be sorted in three categories. One is that we make code faster. The second is that we understand that code. And the third one is having fun. And sometimes we have more fun than on other occasions. The performance profiling, troubleshooting can be very stressful as well. But first of all, we want to speed up code. And speeding up code, becoming the cheetah with 120 kilometers per hour is mainly done by not executing so much code. Java is so verbose, executing so much code on the CPU, and we want to reduce that. And which is not that easy to understand, but Java is not very well known for having a very good efficient memory model. Well, in fact, it has. But it takes a lot of time to do all that memory operations you would need to do in C manually. To help it a bit, we can try not to waste too much memory. And of course, a very good idea for becoming faster at executing stuff is not to wait for stuff to happen. So perhaps we want to not wait until the disk answers with some data and do something else in between. Let's look in detail at code. So what's mainly contributing to code execution time is that when we have Java code, which gets compiled to bytecode, which gets executed on the runtime in some kind of assembler instructions in the end, it consumes CPU cycles. And we can waste a lot of CPU cycles when we do stuff which is not needed or which is inefficient. Now, when we look at code, which is written, there are two main issues, which is frequent invocation. So we invoke stuff very frequently. If we do it once, it's not that bad, except it's slow. So when code is slow, then invoking it once is already bad. And invoking slow code many times is, of course, worse. And unnecessary code is kind of too frequent invocation, meaning that one invocation is already too much. But that happens very often, especially when we use frameworks, for example, like Hibernate. We don't really understand how it works behind the scenes, and we just do because we always do that. And there might be unnecessary code execution. For unnecessary code execution, Java already does stuff for us. Free, so we don't need to care about it. So first of all, Java C, our compiler, is already a smart guy and optimizes stuff. And then Hotspot during runtime, she's already also very nice and optimizes our bytecode after we compiled it. So let's look at two optimization examples you may or may not know. So this first one is a compiler optimization. There is a system out print line in our method, and I want to know when I run this program, is that string printed or is it not printed? What would you say? Is it printed or not printed? No, it's not printed, exactly. And why is it not printed? Ah, Miel, you know this. Exactly. So the answer is it's not in the code. When Java C has run, this line is no longer existing. It's not there. It's not because it's false in runtime. It's because it's not there. The compiler already knows, because it's a final variable, the value can no longer change. It can never become true. So this line of code doesn't exist. And this is a variant of that. We may expect 10 million tests of print being false or true. And this is actually happening for some time until Hotspot detects, well, this value of print seems to be false. Why am I checking it all the time? And it will skip the whole rest execution of the loop. So this code becomes faster after Hotspot discovers this value is false, and it will abort, and it will not perform the 10 million invocations, which is nice. But we can't do that for everything. Coming to memory, Java has automatic memory management, which means we cannot create memory leaks. And one of the most common issues is memory leaks. That sounds contradictory. The reason why Java has no real memory leaks is that we cannot forget the pointer. So when we allocated memory in C, we would get an address, or we would tell the alloc the address we want to allocate, and then we might forget the value of that, and then we cannot free it anymore. In Java, this cannot happen because Java does the mallocs for us on the operating system. It has a heap, and we just get objects, and they are in the heap. But when we forget those objects references that we put them into our code, then we also have a leak. It's a Java memory leak. And we have garbage collection. Garbage collection is great because we don't need to free up objects ourselves. But if the JVM needs to free up so many objects, it will spend a lot of time freeing up garbage and removing garbage. There is not so much time executing code left. And we want to tune it. So one example is here. Again, 10 million iterations of something. And we are actually doing some count up of a value here. So why is there actually garbage collection involved? So garbage collection is cleaning up objects we no longer need. So why? Why is garbage collection involved here? Does anybody? Exactly. That's happening here. When we wrote this code, which is valid since Java 1.4, this is auto-boxed into this. So compiler will do not exactly this, because compiler will do a long value of instead of new long, but it's in principle the same. So new long objects are created in every loop iteration. And the value will be increased, and then we will get a new object long assigned to that variable. So we are creating 10 million temporary objects which we don't need. So we didn't know that, but that's indeed happening. There is a planned optimization for that because it's a pretty common mistake done, and there is a AutoBox elision feature coming in a future JDK update, which will automatically remove the mistake we did as a developer. And as said, memory leaks can happen like this. So we get a key we forget. So I make a random key, so it's very easy to forget it. And we store a string in that caching hash map. And after I forget the key, then there is no way for me to ever access this value again. And besides invoking clear all on that cache, I really cannot get it out. So that's kind of a memory leak. And caches are very, very usual instances of memory leaks. A better implementation of a cache, of course, would be to use some library which does some recently used algorithm and remembers all instances it put into the cache and then removes it when they are no longer needed. But that's a memory leak, and I will show you later how you can find it. But before we really can find it, we need to understand the mechanics involved into finding stuff. And for performance, time matters. Time is basically the number one thing we want to optimize. And time can be measured in two ways. Time can be the time we as humans can somehow feel. Well, we use a clock for that. It's called wall clock time. It's the time which has passed in our life, and we waited for that code to happen. And there is CPU time. CPU time is usually important when you have a multi-core system. So in reality, just 1 second may have been passed. But on the CPU, 8 CPUs have been active for that 1 second. But so the CPU time is much higher. Luckily for us, we don't care about that very often, unless you have a mainframe system where you exactly need to pay for CPU time. In all other cases, CPU time is just good if we can get it high, because that means we use our CPU. And then the problem is, when we measure something, we don't really know the code which is executing. So I show you code. This is code, some kind of pseudo code using arrows. We have the main method running at the bottom, and then we invoke a method foo, and then we invoke method bar from that method. We return to foo, and foo invokes bar again, and then bar is invoked, and it returns, and then the program ends. So I wonder, how could now a profiler figure out what's going on? And the most common technique for understanding what's going on is sampling. Sampling means the profiler looks from now and then into the code, what's actually going on here. So profiler will do this. Aha, profiler sees method foo is currently running. That's great. And method foo is still running. Now bar is running, foo is running again, baz is running, foo is running, and we are done. This was one possible execution. Let's look at another. So this is also possible because the distance between those arrows is basically, so depending on the profile, it's either configurable or it's kind of random or fixed. That's the sampling interval, basically. So you look at something in a specified interval. And for this different code here, slightly different code, we can have very bad luck with our sampling interval. For example, this profiler would look at the defined times and see always the method bar executing. So when we ask the profiler, hey, dear profiler, what was going on in our system? The profiler would reply, well, always when I looked, method bar was executing, so I guess bar took 100% of our time. And okay, we cannot find it out, and we need to trust the profiler, but we can see here on the picture that's not true. Actually, bar is not that important in the code execution. And there's a variant of that problem with cameras. I want to show you that because it's really nice. You can see that chopper is it's flying. It's not fake. That's a real chopper, and it's really flying. And if I would have sound here, then you would hear it's really making noises. But what's going on here is exactly the same problem. A camera also will not look continuously. There is also a frequency involved where a camera takes a picture of something. And this picture taking is unfortunately so synchronized with the rotation of the helicopter that it looks like the helicopter is actually not moving its main rotor. So that's a sampling problem. Same is in movies when you see, for example, wheels going backwards. That's a sampling problem. And profilers are subject to that as well. So there's an alternative, a better approach, or a potentially better approach, which is called instrumentation. Instrumentation requires a few more operations from the Java virtual machine. It needs to allow the profiler to modify the code which is actually running. So here back at our code. And now the profiler goes and builds some custom code into the running code. The red bubbles appearing here is instrumentation code the profiler inserts into the actually running code. And as you can see, the picture somehow gets not so clear anymore. On the right-hand side, there are so many bubbles, you don't really see the line of code executing. So that's a problem with instrumentation, because that causes what's called overhead. Instrumentation code running instead of real code. What you could do, and most profilers do, is they try to automatically remove where it doesn't seem sensible. But in this case, we no longer would see when method baz is invoked, which may be also not what we need. So my first recommendation, the first takeaway I want you to have is when you do profiling, you should always use sampling first because it's low overhead and it gives a good impression of code. You don't know exactly what's going on. But you have to be aware that there is this problem with the sampling interval, and what the profiler tells you may be even greatly wrong. depends on how long the sampling interval is, and it's from 1 to 10 milliseconds usually. And then when you have found something or are in doubt, then do instrumentation. So what I'm going to show you now is how you do it yourself. So because we are programmers, we want to do stuff our own. And later on, I'll show you a better way of doing it using a commercial tool. Unfortunately, the free tools on the profiling market are not that good. So there are two commercial tools which I would recommend, which is JProfiler and YourKit. And there are non-commercial tools like the Eclipse profiling platform or NetBeans Profiler, but they have really problems getting. And my own profiler, of course, has even more problems. So let's do it. I have a demo application, and I'm not going to show you what this does. It's starting what I call the mixed demo first, and then it's doing a mass demo. And I can sample it. So let me run it with a sample demo runner. So what's going on? So this is the output of my sampler. My sampler says in the first three lines here, there is 490 milliseconds of code going on in a method which is called message 500 milliseconds. And in total, it has been for almost 20 seconds? I don't know. We need to figure out why it's that. And then there is a method 100 milliseconds going on, and that's somehow taking almost 300 milliseconds. So that's really interesting. So what did our profiler measure there? And there was a mass demo going on here at the bottom. And that was running this fast code, which profiler claims, and that was going on for 2 seconds. So let's look into the demo, what was really going on to confirm this, what the profiler saw. And well, there's some run code method, and it's in the demo runner, actually. The mixed demo is running code with 100 milliseconds, 1 millisecond, 100 milliseconds, 500 milliseconds, 1 millisecond, 100 millisecond, 1 millisecond, and 50 and 50 milliseconds. Those values are translated to methods with exactly this name. What we notice in the output is that, the output is here as well, that the sampling profiler did neither see the 1 second execution, 1 millisecond executions, nor the 50 milliseconds executions. So that's not seen by the profiler. Try to run it with a better runner. I have something called instrumented demo runner, which is doing instrumentation. And what you see is that it really did see everything which was happening. But what you also see that the code is still running for the second demo. And my fan is currently spinning up. So there is something really odd going on. Let's try to wait until it's done. Inspect the measured code in meantime. So that's pretty correct what's going on here on top. The 1 millisecond method was executing for 5 milliseconds in total, and it had 3 invocations, a number sampling couldn't give us. So sampling doesn't know how often something was invoked. Instrumentation can know that. But you also notice it's still going on. So what's happening in here? Let's investigate our sampler. What does the sampler do? A sampler starts, it's done. Now, finally. And the whole execution took now almost a minute to execute, while when the sampling was active, it was really fast, like 1 second, I guess, it was. So sampler seems not to have so much overhead. So I start a new thread. I set it as a daemon thread, so it's not keeping the JVM alive. And what it does is every time it's running, here in the run method, there's a loop, so it's running forever. And it's sleeping this interval. So 10 milliseconds is the sleeping interval. And when it wakes up, it will ask the system, what is the currently executed method in the thread I'm monitoring? And then it takes the current time and records that information in some data structures, and then it sleeps again. So that's it already. That's the profiler, sampling profiler. So why is the instrumentation profiler so much slower? Well, the instrumentation profiler is implemented using a library called AspectJ, which has those funny things which are called point cuts. And this is a point cut defined on any method in demo. And it's invoked around, which means that I can get the time before the method is executed, and I can get the time after. Actually, the real method is invoked in this line of code. So I take the time before, store it in start, and then take the time afterwards. And then I also do some bookkeeping. So from code perspective, this doesn't seem to be so slow. But what makes it slow is that this code, my code, is invoked for every invocation that's happening. And that was a problem when the mass demo was invoking. I guess that's, we couldn't make it Java 7. So it's 100 million times invoked. So 100 million times also my code was invoked. And that's obviously not a good idea to do. So sampler seems to be superior in here. The code is on GitHub. So you can try it yourself if you want. And there is a blog post also explaining that one. So code profiling is done. We figured out which method was running and how long it took. So now look at memory. So we want to hunt memory leaks. Let's close that all. And hunt memory leaks. Well, let's undo it here so it compiles again. Thank you. Let's directly run it with the, no, that's the wrong one. So many launch configurations. And show it to you. There is a leak demo. What does this leak demo do? Well, it's running. It's running forever until it will throw out of memory exception. And it's adding stuff to a cache, dummy data. It's adding something to a list, and then it also puts that into a leaking map. And the results of my collection analyzer helping me to find this memory leak is basically saying there are many instances of collections which are getting very big because stuff is inserted in them. So this array list has crossed the threshold of 5,000, and what I also added is I noticed it was never reduced, so it's always growing. So that's not a good sign. And there's a second array list. This is even worse because it was never read from it. So only stored to it and never read and never reduced. That also seems like to be a problem. So how is that one doing it? It's also doing instrumentation. And I'm instrumenting method access. So whenever something is put into a collection, I'm recording it. So let's look into that one. And this is basically what I did for lists. When stuff is added to a list, this code is executed. When stuff is read from a list, this code is executed, and when it's removed, this code is executed. And that's just collecting statistics about what's going on, how often is that happening, and if it's happening at all. That's very inefficient. It's a nice idea, but the overhead of my code is so big that it slows down the whole execution. So details are available again on GitHub or in the blog post. But let's use a real tool. So a real tool which is available for everybody to use. It's available on the market. It's called JProfiler. It's quite an ugly tool, and it requires a lot of work to get used to it. But it really helps you to understand what's going on in your application. So let's run it. It has some Eclipse integration, so it's running nicely in Eclipse. And run our demo in profiling. What you see here is that in console, JProfiler reports that it's actually running and doing now stuff with the application. And it asks me to do stuff. And the main decision I have, I know that the UI is not very user-friendly and it takes quite some time for you to read it. It has on top there something called profiling settings as a template. And those two available by default are instrumentation and sampling. So let's start with sampling. And you have seen what my tool reported. And let's see what JProfiler reports. So JProfiler reports JVM has exited. That's true. So my sampler was starting a daemon thread, and it was stopping, and JProfiler is doing the same. It has a daemon thread. And what JProfiler saw is basically much like what I saw. It was seeing here those three methods, 500 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds, and 1 millisecond. And it was seeing fast code was executing as well. And it's not that big of an overhead because it also was finishing in 2.5 seconds in total. So how to read it? It's very easy to read when you switch to a hotspot view. This is a tree view, and it's sorted by the longest CPU time or wall clock time spent. And hotspot view is unfortunately not available because the JVM has exited already. So let's do it again, but with a check mark which prevents that from happening. Profile as. Okay. There's a nice check mark which prevents the JVM from exiting, so I can show you it. And hotspots now will show us what's going on. And you will notice it will show us again the time. So it was a little bit slower, this execution. But that's normal. So don't expect those numbers to be comparable to the very last decimal point. It's totally normal that when you profile stuff, you will get different results for most of your executions. I recommend check the order of magnitude. So is it 10 times slower this time or 10 times faster? Because you really don't want to spend a lot of time checking those 0.0001% deviation of code execution. So in total, run fast code was executing the most. Unfortunately, because it's sampling, we neither have the average time nor the invocation of that code. So we know how to fix it, right? So we do instrumentation of it. So let's do that. We again do profiling. I want to open more windows. And I choose instrumentation, and I also check that keeping alive check mark. So here it's running again. And let's check. It's still running with that 100 million invocations of a very short method. And now it was fast enough. So what we see here is that in JProfiler, it was not so bad, the overhead. The reason for that is JProfiler guys are much more clever than I am. They did a much better algorithm to implement it. So they did it really good. But what you can see at the bottom down here is that it detected an overhead hotspot, which is basically what I did in extreme. And JProfiler asks me now if I really want to collect all that data for that very short method, or if it should remove the red bubbles, so to speak. So that's good. So JProfiler did some more I did, and now I also have a number of invocations, which sampling didn't provide me. The average time of that very short method is indeed very, very short. And while it had some problems getting the average time of the 500 milliseconds method, because it claims average time to be 274 milliseconds. Let's look into that, what's actually going on in method 500 milliseconds. You see that's sleeping. It's not really doing a thread.sleep because thread.sleep might not really sleep that long. I'm doing a manual sleeping using busy waiting, which means that I really do a loop and then check if the time has passed already. So there is some error. There is always error. And profiling tools will never be perfect because they have influence on the program running, and that influence can be quite big. But if you have isolated such an expensive method, you might ask yourself, well, does it really need to do all that much code it's currently doing? Or in that case, so when we sort by invocations, we see it's pretty clear that one is invoked way too often. You could ask yourself the question, well, does it really need to be invoked 100 million times? That's not an easy to answer question, but we might understand what's our program really doing. And to finish, I want to show the memory leak problem. Oh yeah, there's a remark I want to do about CPU profiling, because what I've shown here, those two views are really everything you need to do CPU profiling. You need to be aware of what I told you about sampling and instrumentation, and you need to be aware of not really trusting 100% those numbers. But that's it already. There is not more. You really want to get used to that view, more to this view, and just sort by the biggest offender and then look into the code where it's coming from, who invoked that, and why. Why was it invoked? Had the original developer of that code, maybe it was myself, a real reason to do that? Or was it just because I didn't know it's actually that expensive? But that's it already. For memory monitoring or memory profiling, it involves a bit more magic and understanding on the JVM memory model, which is totally out of scope for today. But let's profile this one here in JProfiler. Thank you. I guess that's okay. So what we see here. So this is the memory view of JProfiler, and it's telling us two things. Instance count and size. Instance count is, of course, easier to get. So instance count, if I create one instance of an array list and add one instance of a string to it, yeah, I can get how that works. Size is difficult because what's actually the size of an object? It can be the object itself, it can be all fields in that object, it can be all objects referenced. And for JProfiler terms in the standard memory view, that's just the size of the object itself. And we see there are a lot of integers created by now, 1.6 million. And from size-wise, 141 megabytes on the top right corner is eaten by character arrays. So we really want to know where is it coming from, huh? So we want to know who is creating those integers. And JProfiler offers allocation hotspots. Let's take that one and calculate them for all live objects. Now JProfiler will tell us where those objects are coming from. And he's telling us, well, the most live objects are coming from string builder toString. And I think I'm running out of memory soon, so it gets slower a bit. And it's really showing me all the code passes where those two string methods are invoked. And we can see my profiling agent I have written. The collection analyzer aspect is actually creating a lot of garbage in memory and creating a lot of pressure. And integers, well, they're created again in my profiling agent, so I better remove it before I go to production. And only a few of the integers and strings are created in the actual memory leak. That's a very important information because when you are running out of memory, you don't have that data available. When you are running out of memory, you usually get out of memory error and I restart because it's faster. And something which is called a heap dump. JVM terminates and dumps the heap to disk. And JProfiler can do that as well. We can manually take one of those heap dumps. I'll do that, and then I'll take some questions. Heap dump has a different kind of information. A heap dump doesn't know which code was executing and creating objects. A heap dump doesn't know what the precise moment in time was when an object was created. A heap dump shows all the interlinked objects. So when I ask a heap dump, okay, there are a lot of integers where, well, let's take the dummy data, that's a bit more easier. Where are they coming from? I can look into the heap dump and ask JProfiler, where are actually those dummy data objects referenced? And it will look through the heap dump and say, okay, there are a lot of dummy data objects. And they are in an object array and in an array list, and that array list is called in cache in leak demo. Of course, in real life, you don't have such good names which will tell you this is a leak. Usually, they hide it a bit better. And you can also aggregate this information, so you really see all those 114,000 instances are coming from two places, which is array content and the map value. And yeah, here it is. And it will point to the same instances of my leak I have. So that's what you can do with heap dumps. You can get the references and who is referencing whom and find out who's holding that data. But what's really good is finding the allocations and finding out which code is actually responsible. And then you can look into the code and just figure out which is the line of code which is doing that. That's the end of my demo and presentation. I hope I gave you some insight into how you actually can do profiling on the JVM, what the two important mechanisms are, and that you can actually quite easily get a lot of data. You just need then to spend time on analyzing. Okay, I guess I'm out of time, so thank you all for your attention. If you have more questions, I'm here all day.